Love, Lead, Live thing going. And last week I showed you guys this slide right here. I just wanted to show it to you. And I'm going to show it to you again because I had something happen this week. And it's the fresh reminder, fresh revelation thing. And you know, the really cool thing is I had a fresh revelation. Yeah. And you're going like, yeah, what's that? What could that possibly be about? Oh, you guys, I love you guys. I love you guys. They
just follow an order.
I know that. Obedience. In the marriage, it's good. Might have that backwards, but I don't know. Let's go with it. Wednesday morning, I got up. I was rushing around. Dave Harum was coming. We were going to do some 6 episodes of the Ernie TV show. And we were going to be on tractors and in hay rooms. I was going to be holding up horses' feet. And I paid for that one. And then brushing, wildfire, just lots of stuff. Well, we got done. And then it's like, okay, I've got to get back on my message. I'd started the framework for the PowerPoint. And it was just go, go, go. And all of a sudden, it's like, I gotta go home and get a smoothie or something. Anyway, it was like 2:30 in the afternoon. And I'm in my office. And I'm thinking, I get my Bible. Because I just really need to take a break and read God's word. And I'm thinking, I haven't even talked to Jesus today. I mean, isn't that horrible? I've been so busy about his business, I hadn't talked to him. So I'm laying on, I got a little couch in my office for those who haven't been in the office. You don't want to be sent to the office. But I'm laying on the little couch and I'm going, Lord, I said, can we talk? I said, I promise I'm not going to ask for anything. I said, I just want your presence. I just need to know you're here right now. And, you know, Jesus once said, we have not because we ask not, right? And he flooded me with his presence. And, you know, it's almost impossible not to ask for anything when you're with Jesus. I'm just saying, because he likes it. He's like, okay. And so then after about 20 minutes of that, he started telling me how he wanted me to present chapter 4. It's like, okay, I didn't want to bring this and make business out of this, but it was so awesome. So that night, Wednesday night and Thursday night both, and last night, when we go to sleep, I know I'm not going to go to sleep for a while, and I'm just excited because I'm going to spend time with Jesus. And so all 3 nights I said, okay, Jesus, I just want to talk. Let's just hang out. It's a beautiful thing. And the reason I'm putting that in the fresh revelation category after all of these years of being a believer is if we truly want to have the love part down, we have to have communication with the Godhead. You know what I'm saying? And if we don't, we'll start becoming more distant and more distant. Pretty soon you're not praying anymore. Pretty soon you're not even reading scripture anymore. Pretty soon you're like ships passing in the night. And I use that phrase because our relationship here mirrors our relationship here, especially in our marriages. So if you're a married couple here today, if you're a married couple, no, I wouldn't pick on you, but here you are. If you don't have the communication piece down, if you're not just like, you know what, let's just talk. No. Oh,
nice try.
Yeah, that's easy for you to say, or not. Wow, it's on. So in our marriages, if we don't tend to them, you know, for it's tough enough in any marriage, but Brenda and I, we have breakfast together on the front porch, and in the evening we sit out, you know, in our chairs on the deck. But a lot of couples, they start drifting. Pretty soon they're not praying together, they're not reading scripture together. Pretty soon they're not communicating, period. And they become passing ships in the night. they just kind of go to sleep, and that isn't even that much fun. You know, so let's mirror our relationship with Jesus Christ as our relationship in our marriages, also our relationships within the body of Christ, to where we are working at it. We are remembering that we haven't talked. We're remembering that we haven't prayed, or we haven't read any of his word. And let's get back into it so that we can love well, lead well, and live well, completely free of all hindrance. You know, I'll tell you guys a little bit later how much this love, lead, live thing is important in God's eyes. It's just, it's huge. So anyway, the other thing about being, let me say something before we start in here, is when you do have that really close relationship with the Lord, I mean, when you can say, hey, can we just talk? I'm not going to ask for anything. I just want to be with you. I want to spend time with you. And you know what? He will inspire us. Say amen. He will, and we'll have insight that we've never had before. Say amen. And we will have direction. Amen. Yeah, that was good. Because he's taken us true north. So let's get in. I know I'm going to mention a little bit of the love, lead, live every week through August. And we'll see different perspectives or different angles. I hate to use that. But yes, and this is the perspective now, is we want to love him so much, we want to spend time with him without asking for anything. Just be in his presence. We can do that easily in worship. But when you're all alone, and I don't know about you, but when I pray at night, my thoughts really get scattered. It's like I have to keep reeling it in. Sorry, Lord. I got off. I was writing that song, and, you know, and I started thinking about, you know, the message that I'm getting ready to give, you know, and he goes, it's okay. We're spending time together. We're spending time together. So this is called A Life for God, the overarching title, but there's other things in here for us. So are you guys ready? Are you ready? There's going to be a lot about suffering in this chapter, but we've got to get a perspective on it. So verse 1 of chapter 4 says, so then, since Christ suffered physical pain, you must arm yourself with the same attitude he had. Be ready to suffer too. You know, are we? And I know there's not a lot of persecution in the part of the world we live in. There's psychological persecution, but hey, sticks and stones. But there's other types of persecution we go through. I mean, other types of suffering we go through. But just hang on here for a second, because he says, if you have suffered physically for Christ, you have finished with sin. It's like, I'm done with this. You won't spend the rest of your lives chasing your own desires, but you will be anxious to do the will of God. Isn't that awesome? You'll actually hit a place in your life where you're trying to be in God's will at all times. I think when I look around this room, I see so many people that are just moved. They've learned so much. They're like sponges, you know, soaking up the wealth and wisdom and the knowledge of Jesus Christ. And this is what he's talking about. You don't want to go do those things anymore. You want to spend time with him. You want to love well, lead well, and live well. And then it goes on, says you've had enough. You've had enough you have had enough in the past of evil things and godless people enjoy. Is there any of us that are still hanging on to any of that? Don't lift your hand. I'm just saying, come on. It's like, wow, this is a different season that God has us in. This isn't the 11th hour. This is the last few minutes of this age, and it's time for the church to get ready to be beautifully adorned. I posted on Made Worthy this week to be beautifully adorned like a bride for her husband, and that's our goal. And then it goes on to talk about the godless people enjoy the immorality and lust, their feasting, drunkenness, wild parties, and everybody's going, yeah, I remember some of those. But listen to this. And their terrible worship of idols. Now, I always try to bring things from the first century to now. And I don't know if any of us are out there chiseling a stone, you know, into an idol or carving a piece of wood so we can worship it. But we do have idols. And probably more before this season of your life, but you still could have idols. And sometimes they're people. You know, people worship everything from movie stars to people that have public notoriety. And they do. They follow them, and they want to hear what they got to say. I know I'm done with that, and that's what this says. But there are still people that kind of follow that. And then there's a whole other angle to this, to where people have a love of money. And Jesus says you can't love God and money at the same time, okay? And so there's a materialistic kind of a idol that happens to where, especially here in America, where it's all about the house and it's all about the yard. You know, you make an idol out of your yard. You know me, I just soon put gasoline down in the yard. You know what I'm saying? And Troy, you know the walnuts kill it off pretty quick anyway. But I'm not out there fertilizing it going, I want the best yard in the neighborhood. I just let it be natural, all natural. So I got dandelions, and, you know, I love those things. They're beautiful. They're yellow, then they turn white, then they blow. So, but I do know people that make an idol out of their yards. And you'll see them on Sunday morning instead of worshiping, or on a Saturday night instead of worshiping. They're just going over their yard. I mean, wow. And I know there's going to be a time where we see perfect grass in heaven. But we're not going to get it here. So it's just a labor that's never ending. And you've made an idol out of your yard or your house or your cars or your toys. And it's empty, empty, empty. It is. You know, when we first started talking about love, lead, live, I told you I saw people in Mexico that were like in tar paper shacks that were the happiest people in the world because they knew how to live. They knew how to live free. They knew how to communicate with their spouses. They knew how to love their kids. They're eating dinner with them, not just saying, hey, see you later. Check you out on Facebook. I'm watching you on Facebook. Don't do anything crazy. No, our families are scattered. Everything is chaos because of the great American idol of money or the great American idol of people. You know, certain stars or music personalities or whatever. Do not worship them. God alone is worthy of our worship. Say amen, somebody. Okay, I can move on now. I got stuck there because this is so important. But then it says in verse 4, of course, your former friends are surprised when you no longer plunge into the flood of wild and destructive things that they do. Anybody know what they're talking about? Oh, man, when I got saved, my whole band, they thought I'd got a hold of some bad acid or something. I mean, they were like, Jesus, what? And even my best friend, after 2 days of telling him we were training for cross country, 2 days of running and me telling him how free I felt, it was just like weight was taken off. I mean, it was just, you know, how it is when you get saved. And of course, that's the same kind of love we want to have right now. But my friend looked at me and says, don't say another word about this Jesus to me ever. Yeah, that knocks the wind out of your sails. And that's what he's saying here. They don't want to hear it. They're surprised when you no longer plunge into the flood of the wild, destructive things that they do. And then they slander you. They slander you. So, you know, some people go, well, you know, not too many people are going to slander me, you know. Well, we're adults, okay? Try being in high school and being a believer. Bullies in the playground, people knocking your books down, your Bibles down, suicide rates still all-time high. So, yeah, there can be persecution for those who've chosen to follow Jesus Christ. But he says, but remember that they will have to face God. They got to face him, who will judge everyone, both the living and the dead. Now, verse 6, before I read it, there's been controversy around this, and it's really stupid, okay? I'm just going to say it. It's just stupid. We read earlier where Jesus went and proclaimed that he had authority. It was from Philippians chapter 2, verse 10, authority over all things in heaven and earth and under the earth. He was talking to the people in hell from the earlier times, And he wasn't preaching the good news. He was just proclaiming his authority and saying, see it, the white throne judgment. But this isn't what this is talking about. It says, this is why the good news was preached to those who are now dead. And this word is akin to the Greek word that says asleep. So this is talking about James and Stephen and anybody you can think of that's a strong believer who's already passed on. Now, it also goes on to say, so although they were destined to die like all people, now they live forever with God in the Spirit because of the gospel. Isn't that an amen? And also people who are really hung up on soul sleep. This is just another bullet in your arsenal to say, hey, absent from the bodies to be present with the Lord. And when Jesus said, today you'll be with me in paradise, and now you can take him here. It says they'll forever live with God in the Spirit. Now, when's that going to change? 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 talks about it. For the Lord himself shall descend from the heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and the trumpet call of God. And then the dead, or the sleeping, will rise. Well, I thought you said they were in heaven. Yeah, it also says that they're coming with him down to the clouds. He's coming to get the bones, okay? He wants to take our bones. It's for DNA purposes, whatever. But it's just like Joseph in Egypt when he told them, do not leave my bones in Egypt. And the children of Israel carried him all the way across the desert. 40 years they carried his bones to get to the promised land. God is not going to leave our bones on planet Earth. It's tainted. It's controlled by the devil. Our bones are coming out of here, amen, and going to be delivered to the promised land. That'll also be the DNA and whatever God's going to do. It's a mystery that gives us our perfect bodies. And if we just happen to be alive and remain, we should be caught up together with the Lord in the sky, in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air. Wouldn't that be awesome if that's like tonight, right now? How about the last song we do and we just like, phew! Because we've got our bones, so he doesn't have to raise our bones, and we'll have brand new bodies, and we'll just be waiting for the marriage supper of the Lamb. Mary and Martha's marvelous macaroni. And other things. Other things. I'm just telling you, it's going to be a great dinner. So, the bride should be waiting and be adorned for the groom, Jesus Christ. That's the bottom line. That's why we do any of this, is so we can get better and better and better and be more adorned, be more prepared, have more oil in our lamps, more spirit in us, walking closer with him, trusting more in him, being more obedient in him. These are the things. This is the love. This is the love so that we can actually lead out, so we can go out, we can be witnesses for him, that we can go out and we can make disciples of all nations, so that we can go out and we can also do service opportunities to feed people and comfort people. And guess what comes after that? We can live freely as Christ wants us to be. Everybody exhale. That wasn't very good. Maybe you ought to inhale first. Exhale. Yes, that's the whole ticket. Then Peter, he changes gears here in verse 7. It says, the end of the world is coming soon. And really, the imminent return of Jesus Christ has been through the whole church age, right? You can point to when it starts. You can say, well, was it the cross? Was it the resurrection? Was it the day of Pentecost? I don't really care, but it started back then. And we're 2,000 years closer to the Lord coming back than anybody ever has been. And we're going to keep getting closer. But he is talking about the end of this age and the beginning of the kingdom age. And we all know the end of this age is going to have a really tough spot. The 70th week of Daniel, I posted on Made Worthy this week about that too. The tribulation period, the 70th week of Daniel, the time of Jacob's trouble. And it's going to be a tough time here on earth for 7 years. And you can believe any theory you want of when the church is going to be raptured out. But I'm going for the pre-trib, baby. I am. And if I'm wrong, so what? But I just soon see the church taken out of here before the real horrible wrath that's going to come on. Plus, he's dealing with the Jews again, and there's really we're up in the marriage supper of the Lamb. And what was the Moses dish I mentioned a few weeks ago? Yeah, there you said. Who said that? Yes, Moses's miraculous meatloaf. So yeah, that's going to be there. But he said the end of the world is coming soon. Therefore, be earnest and disciplined in your prayers. He's saying it's time to get personal. Let's get personal. Don't start singing that song either. This bunch over here sings every song. I don't even know if there is a song like that, but they'd sing it. Therefore, be earnest and disciplined in your prayers. That means start praying, church. And start praying just like I told you I did Wednesday. Jesus, can we talk? Don't go through some formal kind of thing like you're crawling across glass to get to him. Just say, can we talk? I need to talk to you. I need to talk to you. I'm not going to ask for anything. I just want your presence. He always lets you ask before it's over anyway. Be disciplined in your prayers. That means don't let a day go by. You know, do it in the morning, do it in the evening, but we're supposed to have constant contact. So Paul says, pray without ceasing. How do you do that? In his presence. Mowing pastures, just be out there singing and worshiping. Yes, your neighbors will think you've lost it, but then, you know, who cares? Who cares? It could be a witness to them. I hear you on that mower. Oh, yeah. I hear you. Most important of all, continue to show deep love for each other. Deep love for each other. Remember the love for God and the love for others? But this we started talking about in Bible study. For love covers a multitude of sins. What does that really mean? I'll tell you one thing. When I stood at the very, very edge of heaven at one time, I had nothing but the feeling of peace and joy, and I knew there was no condemnation for those who were in Christ Jesus. There wasn't going to be a film ran with every rotten thing that I did. My sins were paid for past, present, and future. I was going to be assessed on what I did with my time and talent and treasure, but it wasn't going to be heavy because I love him and I love others. I have compassion for people. And love covers a multitude of those sins. So when we're going around and we're just like, you know what, I'm storing up every little horrible thing I do. Every little time I get just kind of, you know, I don't even know how to say it without cussing. But anyway, when you just get all with the road rage thing. And, you know, somebody pulls out and you go, okay, no, I handled this. But it went through your mind. I'd like to chase them down and send them out into a cornfield. And God knows that. But we don't have to keep packing our backpack every morning with every little piece of our broken life. We can set it at the foot of the cross because love covers a multitude of those things. If you don't love, Scripture says, you don't have God. That's when you need to start worrying. You know, I have a love for God. I have a strong love for God. I want to be in his presence at all times. I want to worship him. I picture the throne, not when I'm up here because I'm thinking about hitting bad chords, and so is Jacob. He's going, what are you playing, Frank? But when I was at the pastor's conference, I was about this far off the ground because I could worship unhindered, and I just visualized the throne of God because I love him. I love what he did for me, and as a result of that, I love others and have compassion for them just like he had over the multitudes because they were like sheep without a shepherd. Well, you got a shepherd, okay? I'm not perfect. A little road rage once in a while. But you got a shepherd that will grab a bear. I will grab a lion and pull you from its mouth. And if it turns on me, I'll hook it with the jaw and I'll club it to death. That's how I feel about you guys. I feel like a David. And nobody's going to badmouth the living God either. You know what I'm saying? Certain things we just don't put up with. Certain things we do not put up with. So if you've got that kind of love And yeah, you know, you stub your toe and you say something, you're going, gosh, what a disappointment. Don't hang on to that disappointment. Say, Lord, sorry for that. Wow, my toe's sticking out like this. He might even laugh with you. Look at his toe. But don't build it up. Let it go. Hold loosely to the things of this earth and hold tightly to the things that are eternal. I wrote that in a song one time. I got it was called Miracle. Well, the things of this world, hold on loosely now. Then you guys go, hold on loosely, child. But the I'm not going to end it now. But the things of above, hold on tight. I believe. Yeah, that was the end part. I had the whole chick singer thing going. But it is true. I just want to tell you, if you don't understand that love covers a multitude of sins, this is what it's talking about. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And if you love God and you love others, and you're leading and you're living, all the little things that you go, man, I'm a disappointment. Man, I can't believe I did that again. Man, I can't believe that I can't get over what I did. Don't be bringing that stuff forward. Put it at the foot of the cross. And if you just love people, I guarantee you, when you stand at the edge of heaven, you'll feel nothing but a peace that passes all understanding, standing shalom alakim, and a joy that will permeate you from head to toe, and a love that just can't even explain from the one who is love, who the character and nature and essence is love, and that's the Godhead, Elohim. Love covers a multitude of sins. Can you say amen on that? But don't use it to your advantage, like, well, I can, you know, cuss up a storm, God still loves me. It's not what we're talking about. But if you do bend the toe back and say something, just ask forgiveness for it. But he loves you. He loves you enough that he died for you. And when you've signed on to him by surrendering to him, you're a child of God. Just like the song we sang earlier. And then in verse 9 it says, cheerfully share your homes with those who are in need of a meal or a place to stay. He's talking about the end of the age here again. Still talking about the end of the age. Share a meal. Share a place to stay. And you're going, gosh, well, maybe you can't share a place to stay, but you can share a meal. And I don't care if it's sharing a meal with somebody here at the church that got hurt or got sick or going down to Team Jesus. But let me tell you, when we used to work in, Ken will remember this, when we used to work with Restart, and we had all those kids come out years ago, some of you have been around here that long, and one of the cases that just blew me away was a young mother who was a nurse. She had a job, and her husband was killed in Afghanistan. She had two kids, and she became homeless. She couldn't make the payments. It was a two-payment, house. Or a two-family house, however you call that. Two-income house, thank you. And all she needed was a little help. All she needed was maybe a room for a month. And if you've ever thought about doing that for somebody like that, believe me, it will ring into eternity. Because she'll be like a daughter forever, and you've got new grandkids that love you. So I'm not saying go out and try to find somebody. A lot of people that are homeless, I've worked with a lot of homeless people, and a lot of them aren't all there. That's why they're homeless. But a lot of them, it's situation and circumstance that put them there. And a hand up goes a long ways. So this is saying be hospitable in these end times. And then we're going to jump over to the next section briefly and talk about spiritual gifts. God has given you a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them to serve one another. Pause there. Paul says you've got more than one gift. But Peter's just cutting to it. He says, you've at least got one, okay? And people are always going, well, I don't know what my spiritual gift is. Well, he only names two, but they're complete opposite ends of the gamut to make his point. He starts out by saying, do you have the gift of speaking? And a lot of people are like, no. But it says, if you do, and I'm talking to people who do have a gift of speaking or teaching, if you do, then speak as though God himself were speaking through you. Don't make it about you. Make it about him in everything that you say. The glory is to him, through him, and for him. Amen. So be mindful, if you've got a speaking gift, that you're speaking for him, that you're representing him. But then he goes to the other end of the gamut for those who are going, whoosh, I don't have a speaking gift. It says, do you have a gift of helping others? Wow. We've all got that gift, don't we? That could be the greeter that meets somebody for the first time. That can be the person in this room that goes to the new person and makes them feel welcome. It can go to the person who goes out to the horsepower and bonds with an orphan or an at-risk youth for 7 weeks. You know, true religion is helping widows and orphans, James says. So these gifts of helping people are huge. They're huge. And I guarantee you, if you find a gift, helping people or whatever, I guarantee you, God will bring a dump truck up. You'll just hear it coming back. Beep, beep, beep. You're going, what's that beep? And then boom, he will dump other spiritual gifts on you. And they'll explode because of our overarching purpose and our individual callings. And then this is where the gifting lies in, is the third layer. Our purpose. Don't ever tell me that you don't have a purpose, because if you're in Christ Jesus, we have a common purpose: to represent Jesus Christ, to fulfill the Great Commission, to be witnesses to the world. That is our overarching purpose as believers. We've all got that. Okay? We've all got the purpose thing down, common purpose. But our calling, remember, I said this about a month ago, the calling is the vehicle that makes the purpose come alive. That's what gets us there. So if you've got a calling to go to Asia, or how about Nepal? Woo! Yeah. Woo, woo! Or Guatemala. Woo, woo! Come on, guys. Don't make me do your yelling. Guatemala. Okay. Or up the street, or Team Jesus, or horsepower, or your neighborhood, or your school, or your family. The calling is the vehicle that fulfills your overarching purpose. But where the gifting comes in is everybody's got a gift. Everybody's got something that kind of makes their heart do this. And that's what you want to find, because that's the fuel, that's the passion that makes the vehicle called calling actually move towards fulfilling your overarching purpose. Does that make any sense? Say amen if it does. And so this is why we all have, Peter said, at least one gift. I think he was just cutting to it. But I think we have many gifts. And as we explore them, God just does the dump truck thing on us, okay? And we find out, yeah, we have different gifts that could be used in all different kind of capacities. You know, I always told Dave I don't have the gift for computers because I don't want to work on them, okay? You know, so sometimes we refuse any little gift we have just because we don't want to do it. But I do have a teaching gift, and I do have an evangelistic gift, and I have a worship leading gift, and other than that, everything else is downhill with road rage but I'm just saying, use what you got. Identify what it is that really stirs your cocoa, and that is the gift that brings passion and fuel to your calling, and then we can fulfill our overarching purpose of reaching the world for Christ. Amen? Okay. Got past that. Actually, he's not done. He says, do you have the gift of helping others? Then do it with all the strength and energy that God supplies. Why would he say, if you've got the gift of helping others, do it with all the strength and energy that God supplies? Because it's heavy lifting. You know, volunteer with Team Jesus. Volunteer with horsepower sometimes. It's heavy lifting to go out and invest in a child, or to give a meal and preach the gospel to somebody under a bridge. It's heavy lifting, and you have to somehow find a way to pace yourself so you don't have burnout, so that it's all good, that you're just on fire, that you're being used by God with your spiritual gift to fulfill your calling and complete this overarching purpose, so that we can go to heaven and hear Jesus Christ say, well done, good and faithful servant. Anybody? That's the goal. That's the goal. Strength and energy that God supplies. then everything you do will bring glory to God through Jesus Christ. Everything you do will bring glory to God through Jesus Christ. I mean, don't fly past that verse. Everything that we do. You know, some people think that when I talk about worshiping in the spirit, because that's the worshipers that God wants, because he is spirit, Jesus told the woman at the well, or praying in the spirit, or operating in the spirit as much as we can. I was talking to Lori Harris the other day, and I said, you know, how about service in the spirit? And she's going, well, that's kind of physical, isn't it? Let's get physical. No, we're not going to get physical because we are serving in the spirit. And she said, well, okay, give me an example. And I said, okay, you're going to give the best perfect peanut butter sandwich. I've seen you guys make them too. And Brenda made the perfect one, remember? The perfect peanut butter sandwich. And as you're giving it to that person who's hungry, I mean, they're hungry. And you're remembering, Jesus says, if you do it to the least of my people, you're doing it to me. And you're going, Jesus, take this peanut butter sandwich. It's perfect, by the way. Take it. And then all of a sudden, you're serving in the spirit. Is anybody getting this? We want to do everything in the spirit. And why? It says right here, then everything you do will bring glory to God through Jesus Christ. And then he makes this declaration that I just love. He says, all glory and power to him forever and ever. Amen. All glory. Amen. All glory to him. We don't want to be glory vampires. Remember? No. We want all the glory to go to him. So everything we do is about him. Everything we say is about him. Every random act of kindness is about him. Every time you want to pray with a waitress or a waiter, it's about him. It's not trying to show off that you're spiritual. It's about him. Amen. Suffering for the cause. Verse 12. Dear friend, don't be surprised at fiery trials, at the fiery trials you are going through, as if something strange were happening to you. Instead, be very glad, for these trials make you, and listen to this, they make you partners with Christ in his suffering. Anybody here want to be a partner with Jesus Christ? You're going to suffer somehow. There's an effort that has to be put out. There's heavy lifting if you're going to partner with Jesus Christ. You can't just be a pew potato or, you know, just whatever. You know, I'm saved, so I know I'm going to go to heaven, so why should I lift another finger? Well, first off, that's a bad attitude. And second off, you'll be assessed on that one. Keep swinging as the balls keep flying over the plate. That's what he's asking us to do. And that way, we can partner with Christ in his suffering so that you will have a wonderful, if that's for me, tell him I'm not here. So that you will have the wonderful joy. Anybody want wonderful joy? Wonderful joy of seeing his glory when it's revealed to the whole world. Someday, when Jesus Christ is revealed to the world, coming down on the white horses, and we're being revealed with him, and that's what we're going to be saying. We're with him. We're with him. Because we partnered with him a long time ago. And it even includes suffering. It's not just the lightweight stuff. Hey, I'm in all the way, unless there's some kind of suffering. Get over it. We've got to be all in. You can't be one foot in and one foot out. Hokey pokey, by the way. I got that right this time. The hoochie coochie, I had that. That was on video. Wow. Can't believe it. Shepherd without a clue. So it says you're going through suffering, right? So it says be happy when you are insulted. Be happy when you're insulted for being a Christian. For then the glorious Spirit of God rests on you. Oh, isn't that what we want? The glorious Spirit of God to be resting on us. You can take a lot of stuff if you got the glorious Spirit of God resting on us. And then it says, if you suffer, however, it must not be for murder, stealing, making trouble, or prying into other people's affairs, like malicious gossip, stuff like that. That's not bringing glory to God. You're suffering. That's like saying, well, I'm suffering in prison. Well, no, you got there for a reason. But it is no shame to suffer for being a Christian. Praise God for the privilege. Praise Him. Say praise Him. Praise Him for the privilege of being called by His name. We're with Him. Remember? We're with Him. For the time has come for judgment, and it must begin with God's household. Now, we're talking about an assessment here, but we still need to talk about cleaning house. That's what we're talking about here, cleaning house. You know, are there things in your household that don't need to be there? Are there things in your life that really don't need to be there? Are there things that we're hanging on to? They could be things that are really detrimental, like, you know, addictions, habits, hang-ups, that are just plaguing us. I mean, they're just like, I just can't seem to get past this. But it's time to clean house. Church, it's time to clean house. What are you hanging on to that isn't God-honoring? What are you hanging on to that doesn't give glory to God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit? And then it says, and if judgment begins with us, it's an assessment. It's like, okay, what are you guys doing again? And why are you doing it? If it begins with us, what terrible fate awaits those who have never obeyed God's good news? I don't want to find out. I signed on with Jesus Christ a long time ago. And I went right to the back of this book and found out we win. And that provoked me to read the whole thing. I didn't want to invest in a losing team. But we win. We win, and we're partners with Him. But listen to this. Peter, remember the Galilean fisherman? No real formal education. He quotes Proverbs 11:31 and says, if the righteous are barely saved, what will happen to the godless sinners? Wow. Have you ever felt like you were barely saved? I have. It's like, I don't think I brought anything to the table here. Wouldn't it be easier if we could, like, do something? You know, like spin plates or, you know, something? Knock on, you know, okay, if you knock on 999 doors, or 777 doors would be better. Don't stop at the 666 doors. Do not give up there. But it says if we're barely saved, it doesn't mean we're not saved. It's just that whole thing of we didn't bring anything to the table. Jesus paid it all. All to Him we owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, and He washed it white as snow. So when you think about what kind of hoops do we have to jump through to become a Christian? If you're listening to me, even if you're listening to me abroad, if you think, okay, I need to jump through some hoops. No, there's one hoop. You got to jump through the hoop where you surrender to Jesus Christ. You don't have to jump through another hoop. You're already the devil's child by default. You were born there. So there's one hoop. Jump through it. If you haven't, just jump through it. And on the other side, no, you are saved. It's by grace, through faith, not by works, lest anyone should boast. But we do want to know that we've been saved for works, amen? That we want to bear fruit, amen? That we want to please the Father, amen? So we want to keep on swinging when those balls come across the plate. Don't ever give up. Ephesians 6:9 says, for just at the right time, you'll reap a harvest of blessings if you don't give up. So do not give up. And then this leads me to the ministry of suffering. And we're going to be kind of ending here in just a minute. The ministry of suffering. Now, this doesn't mean that you're being persecuted. There's plenty of people being persecuted. Oh, the world's full of it, especially in the Middle East. But they're being persecuted. But there's also a ministry of suffering. And if you've got some kind of disabilitating disease or chronic depression, or you can name a litany of things that could fall into this category, and you're suffering. You're suffering. There's a ministry of suffering. Has anybody ever heard of this? There's a ministry of suffering, and it's up to us. I wrote a piece on this 3 years ago called the Tale of Two Choices, kind of like the Tale of Two Cities. And we either have the choice to get down in a fetal position and just say, woe is me, and we can stay there, and we can lick our wounds, and we can be no good to anybody, no glory to God, no witness to others. We're ineffective and unproductive in the gospel, and there you are. Wow. Or we can get up, maybe not physically, but get up spiritually and get to the top of that mountain and start proclaiming the good news. You can do that without even being, you don't even have to be out of bed. Tell somebody to give you a phone, write a devotional, get on a prayer chain, start doing intercessory prayer, start witnessing. If you're in a hospital, witness to every single person that steps in that room. Every single person, not just people you know are believers. Go for the ones that are of other faiths. Go deep for him. This is our time to shine here in this 11th hour that we're in, so we can be beautifully adorned like a bride for her groom. Amen. I want to close with a thank you for the amen. I mean, and it doesn't matter what age you are. Don't go, gosh, well, I'm kind of past the age of going to the mission field or anything else. Stop it. Stop it. There's no retirement for ministry. You go till he's done with you. I want to read you from 2 Corinthians chapter 11. I think I'm starting in about 23b, halfway through 23. We'll go to 27. Paul's talking about, I've been put in prisons more often than anybody. Prison. He says, I've been whipped times without number. I faced death again and again. And then he gets specific. He says, 5 different times the Jewish leaders gave me 39 lashes. People hardly live through one of those. 5 times he was beaten, 39 lashes. Once and 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Remember that scene outside the city gates? He was dead as dead could be. I think that's when he caught a glimpse of heaven and said, no mind has imagined, no eye has seen, no ears heard the things that God has prepared for those who love him. 3 times I was shipwrecked. Once I spent the whole night and a day adrift at sea. I've traveled on many, many long journeys. I faced danger from rivers and from robbers. I face danger from my own people, the Jews, as well as from the Gentiles. I face danger in the cities. I face danger in the desert. I face danger in the seas. Is he getting a free ride, guys? Ministry of suffering. And I have faced danger from men who claim to be believers but were not. I've worked hard and long. I've endured many sleepless nights. I've been hungry. I've been thirsty. I've gone without food. And I have shivered in the cold without enough clothes to even keep me warm. Light and momentary problems. Now Paul, once he got his last stay at the Roman Hilton prison, and he knew he had a death sentence, Nero had already said, we're gonna cut your head off, we're just waiting till good time. And Paul laying there, wet, dirty, just imagine being chained to a wall. And you know what he said after all this, knowing he'd had the death sentence? He said 3 words. I choose joy. Say it with me. I choose joy. And we have to say the same thing as a church. No matter what happens to us, we'll come around each other. No matter what we go through, we'll come and bear with each other. No matter what we go through, it's light and momentary. And say it with me, I choose joy. Let's just close our eyes. It's hard to just choose joy. It's hard. You have to resolve that you're in a different season. And just thank God for it. Because it's a season closer to seeing Him face to face. But if there's anybody in this room that has not jumped through the only hoop that you have to jump through, that they have not surrendered themselves to Jesus Christ by faith and received the grace that gives them eternal life, the grace that will give them eternal bodies, and the beauty of the place that we're going to see where no mind is imagined, no eye has seen, no ears heard, the things by which God has prepared for those who love Him. If that's you, nobody's looking, just lift your hand and I'll know how to pray. There's somebody here that wants to jump through that hoop of salvation here tonight. Be thinking about it. And if you're watching at home, just come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Is there anyone here in this room for time and for eternity? If Jesus comes tonight, you know you're going to heaven. If you can't say that, is there anybody here? Lift a hand. And for the rest of us in this room, yeah, you're going to face fiery trials. You're going to face physical trials. You're going to face it all. Nobody gets a pass, not even the Apostle Paul. But when you can say, I choose joy, I choose joy, it changes everything. And we don't have to fight these battles. God's fighting our battles. He's going before us and He's going behind us. He's fighting our battles. Can we trust Him with that responsibility? Lord, we want to trust You with that tonight. And all God's children said, what? Amen. We're going to end with a song called Battles. In whatever battle you're going through, let me tell you, Jesus Christ is bigger than it. He's bigger.